ATN World News, news and inspiration with Leah Tillock.
Hello and welcome to ATN World News. I'm Leah, and it's great to be with you, the listeners around the world. Well, today we are very, very happy to have with us Michael Card. And since his debut in 81, Michael has sold more than 4 million albums. He has written 19 number one singles, and he has also authored several books, including a Gold Medallion Book winner. I say it again, I'm so thrilled to have Michael. Good morning.
Good morning, Leah.
Well, I tell you what, I don't know what time this is going to air with certain stations around the world, but I know that at this time that we're recording, it's near Easter, and many Christians call it the Resurrection Day, Victory of Christ. And I thought that we would start this program off first with a wonderful song from Michael called Love Crucified Arose. Amen. What a beautiful, touching song in the spirit. Love Crucified Arose. Well, Michael, I'm so happy to be talking with you today because there is such a need in the body of Christ. Right before Christ's return, the birth pains are severe. We read in the news things that we haven't read in our lifetime of the persecution of Christians, the beheadings, the tortures, the sufferings, things with ISIS. And then even here in America and parts of Europe where there's more prosperity maybe for Christians, there's still suffering. Scripture says all those who live godly in Christ Jesus will suffer persecution. And there's a mystery in the suffering of the cross of Christ. But God would have us be encouraged through all of this, that we are partakers of his suffering. And Michael has written and touched on this particular topic of sorrow and suffering. And Michael, I'm handing the microphone over to you, and please address our listeners. Thank you.
Well, yeah, Leah, I think it's interesting that those of us who are followers of Jesus, many of us wear crosses around our necks. The cross is a focus for us. And I think with ISIS and Boko Haram and the other violent expressions against Christianity, they're bringing the cross back. I mean, we're actually, it's horrible to see, but we're actually seeing people being crucified again. And I think you're right. I think it's a time for us to wake up and realize we wear this symbol of suffering around our necks, and yet when suffering comes into the world, we act like we don't know what it's for, or that it could it have any purpose. And if we have a unique message as followers of Jesus, I think that message is that suffering can be redemptive, and that God actually uses it. And even your suffering and my suffering, if our suffering has a purpose in that God is using it for our redemption, and can even use it to encourage those who are in prison. And the writer of Hebrews says that we can be with those who are in prison as if we were their fellow prisoners. We can actually join through prayer in the sufferings of other people throughout the world. And that, I think, is remarkable. My sister lost two children in 13 months. My brother lost an 18-year-old son to cancer. I just came yesterday from the funeral of a friend whose 25-year-old son died of an overdose of heroin. So there's this suffering going on all around. And yet at that funeral yesterday, I saw so many people turning to the Lord, so many people who haven't asked very redemptive questions, beginning to ask the right questions. And the family of my friend, they were such witnesses to who Jesus is and what he means in the face of this unbelievable suffering. And so I think the conclusion is God uses suffering to save the world. He used the suffering of his own son, most especially, but our suffering can even have a purpose and can be used in terms of redemption. I think that's that's part of the best news of the good news. Your suffering can actually have a purpose.
Absolutely. And I pray that this really resonates and minister to those listening, that so many times today we get a false message of saying, well, if you're suffering, you're not doing something right. And
these
are people, they lack the word of knowledge of the Bible. I feel like saying, are you really reading the Word of God? Did you read that we are partakers of Christ's suffering, and to think it not strange when these things happen? Michael, what can believers do today to really get the Word of God rooted in their heart concerning suffering and pain, to know how to deal with it properly?
Yeah. Well, I think the great question is, okay, so what do we do? What do we do with our suffering? What do we do with our confusion, even our anger? What do we do with those things? And I immediately think of Psalm 51. Psalm 51 is the psalm that David wrote after this disastrous relationship with Bathsheba, as a result of this adulterous relationship. She gave birth to a little boy, and when that boy was born, they could tell that he was sick. He wasn't going to make it. And so as David was lamenting this dying child, he writes Psalm 51. And there's this turning that happens in Psalm 51. Of course, at this point, David is the worship leader of all Israel. He's not just the king. He's the worship leader. And he writes in Psalm 51 that it's not the blood of bulls and goats that God wants, that the sacrifices of God are a broken spirit and a contrite heart. So as David, who has committed every sin you could commit, I mean, murder, adultery, he's lied. Basically in one fell swoop, he kind of knocked out all 10 commandments. David realizes that all he's got left is all God ever wanted in the first place. And that's an enormous thing to realize, and it changed everything for Israel. So the thing that God wanted most was his heart and his broken spirit. And David realizes that all he's got left is all God ever wanted in the first place, which I think changes everything.
It really does, and that's putting it in biblical perspective. And I encourage you, the listener, if you haven't been in the Word of God for a while, to get into it, because for the lack of knowledge, its people are suffering. They're not knowing how to biblically deal with attacks, pain, suffering, and his anointed word is a healing balm. It truly is. I think that it can do more for you than anything else in a given state of distress. What are some of the pitfalls, Michael, as people maybe are experiencing negative things in their life right now? What are some pitfalls they can avoid getting into as they're going through this?
Well, I think the biggest pitfall is failing to realize that when we do suffer, when we are confused, that first of all, God has not abandoned us. In fact, at that point, I think God is close to those that are suffering, those that are brokenhearted. And instead of turning away and thinking God doesn't want to have anything to do with us, we realize at that point, like David did in Psalm 51, that the appropriate thing to do with that confusion and that sorrow is to offer it up as an act of worship. I mean, if you look at the life of Jesus, and that's where I always go when I'm trying to understand things, you ask yourself the question, when Jesus is most being used by God, what is he doing? And the answer is he's lamenting. In fact, he's lamenting in the words of David's Psalms. So could it be that at the point in our lives when we're most being used by God is that point where we fail to let go? I mean, we refuse to let go. And even in our suffering and our confusion, even in that temptation to say, God, why have you forsaken me? We keep the conversation. We don't leave the dance floor until the music stops. And we'll discover in the process that God is committed to us. He's not going to let you go. Anything you need to say to God when you're suffering, you're free to say to God. And if you don't have the words, the Psalms will give you the words.
That's excellent. Yeah, the Psalms will give you the words. You can relate to it. David was unabashed in his emotions and feelings, and he put it out there. And just like he was unabashed in dancing before the Lord, I mean, he really revealed his heart to God, and God adored that form of worship that doesn't mm-hmm. hold back. And that, I mean, that's intimate, and that's what God's looking for. I want to know you. And so many times, to think that heaven and hell, where you spend eternity, is based on whether God knew you or not. And yet, many of us don't want to pay the price of intimacy on this earth, which may be some sorrow and suffering, to get to know him. Another key point is we need to fear the Lord and reverence him, because that's the beginning of all wisdom, that things are serious. And we need to, as we look at the pain in our lives, look at things, we need to reverence God through it, try and have a good process through it, through the reading of the Word of God. Well, I thank you so much for touching on this issue today, Michael. It's been such a blessing, and I pray this has ministered to people deeply today. You know, God loves you. And we love you. And I always end the broadcast by saying, until next time, I'm Leah reminding you that God truly does love you.